Hello friends, this is Durga again from Technology Mentor slash IT Varsity, and as of now we are seeing what HDFS is. We have built a 6-node cluster on AWS or 4-node cluster using VMs, and we have added HDFS service to the cluster using Ambari web interface, and then we actually copied a file as well as part of the previous demonstrations after setting up our cluster either on our laptops using virtual machines or on AWS provisioning EC2 instances. So continuing on HDFS, now we will see what are the major things that you need to keep in mind while setting up HDFS or after setting up the HDFS. So first thing is slaves and masters. So we need to configure slaves and masters, and you need to have an understanding about configuration files, and then you will see how to validate certain things, and then we will talk about files and blocks, and then we will talk about something called rack awareness, and then verifying logs and browsing the file system using command line as well as web interfaces. Now if you think about it, data nodes are the slaves. Data nodes are the ones which will actually store the files, and name node will have the metadata of the file. So you will understand what how the files will be stored in the data nodes. There's a concept of block size, replication factor, and a file will be divided into blocks and distributed across all the data nodes. You will understand those things in a moment. And once the file is distributed into blocks and once the file is splitted into blocks and distributed onto multiple data nodes, you have to capture the relationship between the file, block, and the block location. And that is called as metadata. So name node will have that metadata information. And secondary name node is the helper to the name node. And we will see all those things in a moment. For now, we ignore MapReduce. MapReduce will be used for processing. As of now, we are only focusing on the HDFS. So data nodes will be running on all the slaves in our cluster, whereas we will have two or three masters where we will have name node and other associated components in a production size cluster. And so once you have these masters and slaves, the master, which is name node, need to understand whether slaves are up and running. The reason is when you try to copy the file, the request will go to the master, and master need to know what all slaves are up and running, how the data is distributed, and also it has to get metrics and the free space on the file system on all the slaves. Only using that information, name node can determine which data nodes should be used to store the blocks of the files. Again, blocks are created by the HDFS binaries itself. If the file size is abnormally high, the file will be divided into multiple blocks, and it has to be distributed on all the slaves. And the only way master can know whether slaves are up and running and also to have the statistics is by using a concept called heartbeat. So as part of the heartbeat, data nodes will poll name nodes saying that I am up, and it runs every second. And there are certain parameters which we'll see. I will tell you the location of the files. I might not tell you all the parameters, but there are parameters which will control how frequently this heartbeat should be done. By default, it's every second. All the data nodes will send notification to master or name node every second that they are live. And along with that, they also send additional information about the statistics, how much CPU is being used on the servers, how much storage is free, and all those things. So having this information up to date, the daemon process that will be running on name node will be able to determine on which data nodes the blocks associated with a file has to be saved. So it is a complex algorithm. One of the criteria to determine is the amount of storage. It will try to evenly distribute across all the data nodes. And there are several other criteria also, and we will not be getting into all those details, and we don't need also. And then configuration files. Before getting into configuration files, let me show you how you can get certain information from the background about our name nodes and data nodes. For this, I am demonstrating using my 4-node cluster on virtual machines. And I am logging into the first server, which is hdpserver.itversity.com. And I am running a command called ps-fu. Again, we can actually use SSH like this, and then we can issue a command a Linux command to get the output directly without giving control or without changing the context to that server. So if you just use this command and hit enter, the context will be changed to that server, and all the commands will be running on that server until you type a command called exit and come out of it. So as we have 4 nodes, instead of logging in and running commands and exiting it, we can use SSH command like this, and then we can pass a command like in double quotes. In this case, let's say ps-es grep node, because the data node as well as name node have the node in common. So you will know what are the name nodes or data nodes running on a particular server. This is a very important command, because if your monitoring services are down, still your Hadoop cluster might be working without any issues. And in that case, these commands will come handy to troubleshoot whether there is any issue in Hadoop or not. So instead of panicking, you just run these commands, make sure Hadoop cluster is up and running, and focus on the management tools. If you don't know these commands, then you will struggle and you think that something major happened, even though everything up and running with respect to Hadoop. And hit enter. So if you see, when I run this command, you can see that it didn't return anything with data node or name node or secondary name node, because the cluster is down. So if you get a request, and if you want to validate whether the daemon process related to Hadoop are up and running or not on a given node, then you have to use this command called ps-ef. It's a standard Linux command which will list all the process, and out of them we just want to see all the process that have name that have node in them. And as of now, nothing is running, so there is something wrong in the cluster. And I went to the Ambari, and I started. I issued the start all services, and now it is starting up. Once it is done, we will see whether the process are up and running or not. So already the components on data nodes are already up and running. So let's see. Let's validate while the components on HTTP server is coming up. So in this case, now I'm just changing the server name. Now if you see the output, you can see there is a process called proc underscore data node. This is the main one. And we have configured NFS gateways also. You can ignore these two. The reason why it is showing these two are showing up is somewhere in the process they might have data node or name node in them, and that's why it is showing up like this. To be more specific, we will just grep on data node and hit enter, and you can see that only one process means we got only one result, and this process is data node process. Similarly, we have all the HDFS services up and running, so we can actually issue the previous command with HTTP server, and we will say grep minus I name node, and it should, as I'm running on my virtual machines, it will show two services, name node and secondary name node at the least. If you run the same command in AWS in a 6-node cluster, on gateway node or client node, you will not see any process. On the second node, where we have configured name node, while setting up the HDFS service, you will see the one process which says proc underscore name node. And on the third node, you will see this one proc underscore secondary name node. And on the slaves, you will see data node. So that's how you can actually see the daemon process or HDFS related components running on a cluster or not from the backend, even when you don't have the front end Ambari or Cloud Era managers. That being said, let's go to the next topic, configuration files. So as every software product or software application, we have configuration files with respect to HDFS as well. And these are the three primary configuration files, Hadoop env.sh, CoreSite.xml, and HDFSSite.xml files. And the location of for these XML files is cd /etc/hadoop/cons. And okay, I'm outside the server, that's why it failed. Now let me do SSH and log into the server and change the context to the server. And now let me show you cd /etc/hadoop/conf. And you can issue ls/ldr. There are a bunch of files, but we are interested only in HDFSSite.xml, CoreSite.xml, and Hadoop env.sh. So these are the three files which will have all the parameters controlling HDFS. CoreSite.xml have parameters which will be used by both HDFS as well as Yarn or MapReduce. But these three are the files which will contain all the parameters related to HDFS. Okay, and let me show you Hadoop env at this time, and you can see bunch of export commands, which means you have class path variables, and also you will see bunch of memory related parameters. So these are all memory related. And if you go to the web interface and if you click on configs, so when you try to set up the cluster, it asked you to review these configuration parameters and also to modify if required. And all these memory related parameters will be saved in Hadoop env.sh. So if you make any modifications, those modifications will be saved in Hadoop env.sh. And one main thing you need to remember is the web interface will hide some of the complexities complexities that are related to configuration files when it display here. In OS level, you have three files, but you don't see a HDFSSite.xml, CoreSite.xml, Hadoop env.sh in Ambari or Cloudera manager URLs where you can change the configuration. Rather, they will categorize all the parameters that are related to HDFS and provide as standard settings and advanced settings. Okay, so this is the main thing which you need to understand, the relationship between the underlying configuration files and the web interfaces that are provided for you to facilitate modifying the configurations. That being said, modifying the parameters, you should never, when you are using tools like Ambari or Cloudera Manager, you should never modify parameters directly in the files. You only should change here. So if you want to change the directory path for name node or data node, you have to make the changes here and you have to save it. And those things will be in effect after restart in most of the scenarios. So either standard settings or advanced, you have to follow the same approach. And then understanding final. So all these parameters, whatever is there in HDFS site .xml, CoreSite.xml can be modified at runtime. And if you want to restrict that, You can, so if you look at hdfsi.xml, the parameters will look like this. Okay, it has the property tags for each parameter and then name and a value. And if you want to make something final, what you have to do is you have to add final tag like this and make it true, and it will be final. You cannot change those things at runtime. If you have to change, you have to change using Ambari configuration interface, or you have to change in underlying XML files, and you have to restart the services if you want to change a parameter. But you can never change at runtime if you define it as final. So we will see how to change the parameters and all those things at runtime later. For now, this is the main thing you need to understand about configuration files. That being said, I will wrap up for this video, and we will continue talking about HDFS. We have a lot more content that needs to be covered, and we will see that. I hope you are enjoying my content in the channel. If you have not subscribed yet, please do so. And if you like the videos, please click on like, and feel free to post a comment or ask a question on the comment section of the respective videos. Thank you. Bye.